All right, let's now talk about convolutional autoencoders. And along with this topic, we will also talk about transposed convolutions and deconvolutions, which are also sometimes called strided convolutions. And I will also tell you why we need them. So here's an overview of how a convolutional autoencoder looks like. And if you just look at this figure here, it looks exactly like what you've seen for the fully connected autoencoder. The only difference is now that instead of using fully connected layers, we are using convolutional layers for the encoder. And for the decoder, we are using these so-called deconvolutional layers or strided convolutions. So why do we need them? I mean, before, when we talked about CNNs in the convolutional neural network lecture, we used regular convolutions to downsample the images. So they become, from the original size, they become smaller as farther as more convolutions we use and pooling layers. And how can we now reverse this? So how can we now go from a smaller representation to a larger representation? So for that, we need to kind of invert this convolution process. So for that, we are using these so-called deconvolutional layers. So there are many different words for that. So overall, what we are interested in when we talk about transposed convolution or deconvolution is that we want to increase the size of the output compared to the input. So what we want is we want to start with a smaller input and obtain a larger output. Basically the opposite of the regular convolution. And like I said, there are different synonyms for this process. So sometimes it's called deconvolution. But mathematically, if you would want to be use the precise, let's say, notation, mathematically a deconvolution is defined as the inverse of a convolution, like the mathematical inverse, the inverse of a function. But we don't really need this or do this in the context of deep learning. So in deep learning, it's kind of enough to just have a convolution that upsamples. It doesn't have to have exactly the inverse computation. So in that way, we call that also sometimes transposed convolution. I guess the name comes from the fact that we go like the opposite, from instead of going from large to small, we go from small to large. But even that term is a little bit, I would say, weird. So sometimes people also use the term unconv or unconvolution. And sometimes people also use the term fractionally strided convolution, which might be a better term for that if you consider how it is implemented. And I will show you in the next couple of slides how this transposed convolution, also known as fractionally strided convolution, is implemented. But again, if you read a deep learning paper and people talk about a deconvolution or unconv layer or transposed convolution or fractionally strided convolution, chances are that all of these mean the same thing. So usually people use all these words synonymously. And how it's implemented, I will show you in the next couple of slides. So at the top, to start with, let's take a look at a regular convolution first. So here at the bottom, we have the input in blue, and the output is at the top here in dark green. So this is a convolution with a 3x3 kernel, right? So you can see that here, it's a 3x3 kernel. And if you look from here to here, it's going by 2 pixel dimensions. So it has a stride of 2. So we are going here, and then the next here, and then we go down by 2 pixels. So actually we start at the left corner again. So we are here now, and then we move again by 2 positions. So it's just a regular convolution that you have already seen here with a 3x3 kernel and a stride of 2. And it outputs this 2x2 feature map. So in each iteration, that it generates 1 pixel or 1 value. And then you get this 2x2 output. Now the transposed convolution is shown at the bottom, also with a stride of 2 and 3x3 kernel, and it is doing the opposite. So that's maybe why it's called a transposed convolution, because it's doing it kind of backwards. So here now you start with a 2x2 input. So the 2x2 input, and what you get out is a 5x5 output. Right? So here we have at the top again, we have a 5x5 input and a 2x2 output. So it's kind of doing the opposite. So the computation is that we go here from 1 pixel, and then we have our 3x3 kernel, and we obtain a 3x3 output. So in a regular convolution, if you have the kernel, you multiply each value here with a pixel value. So each weight is multiplied with a pixel value. In the transposed one, it's essentially you take this value here, the 1 pixel value, and multiply it also by each value in the kernel, so you get 3x3 outputs. And then you move one position to the right, and in the output also, by if you have a stride of 2, you move by 2 pixels. So in this way you create this 5x5 output from the 2x2 input. So essentially going from a small image into a big image. Now, this is how it conceptually works. So if I go back one more time, so at the bottom here, this is how I like to think about a transposed convolution. This makes sense to me, this is intuitive to me. So again, here, this is again what I showed you on the previous slide. That's how I think about it. However, in practice, this is usually emulated with a direct convolution. So there's this excellent paper linked here, a guide for convolutional arithmetic for deep learning that I mentioned earlier in this class when we talked about convolutional networks. And in this paper, they also describe the so-called emulated approach using a direct convolution. So instead of implementing this process, there's a process that just uses a regular convolution to implement this transposed convolution. It's just both things here on this slide are achieving the same thing. It's just a different way of carrying it out. So in order to go from this 2x2 input to this 5x5 output, you can also implement it with this emulated approach where you put these paddings onto the input. So here we have a stride of 2 and a 3x3 kernel. So in this case, what would happen in this emulated approach, it would put here this padding. So what I'm highlighting here, this is like all padding. All these dotted lines are padding. It's adding the padding around the input image, and also it adds the spacing between. That's because of the stride. So, and this is maybe why it's also called fractionally strided convolution. It's a weird word, but yeah. So if you look at this at the bottom and you think a little bit about this, you can think about that. So if you walk through this mentally step by step, you should be able to see that both the top and the bottom part here, they produce the same, or not these parts, but if you completed this whole process here, it should give you the same results as the completed feature map here. Because here you take also a 3x3 kernel, but here you only consider this pixel. These other ones are essentially zero. And then you project it up to here. And this is essentially kind of the same as you are projecting this one up here in that way. And then you move this one to the right, and then you do the same thing now with this region here. Well, you have a stride of 1, I think. So you're moving here, and then you do the same thing again, but now it's in a different position. It's now in the kernel at this position here. The first iteration, let's say this was the first, and in the second round it would be at this position, and this one will go here. And you continue, and at some point when you go one row down, it will overwrite and things like that. So in that way, it will give you essentially also this 5x5 output when you completed this, when you went also through the next rows. So long story short, I don't like to think of it like this because this is kind of complicated, like doing the padding and putting these things apart. In my head, when I think of a transposed convolution, I think of it as like this, which I find more intuitive. But technically, yeah, the implementation is, I think, simpler in code if you just reuse the convolution with this padding setup. Okay, here's another example. Here it's a regular convolution with stride 1, going from a 4x4 input to a 2x2 output. And here it's a transposed convolution emulated with a direct convolution. So this is, again, an emulation. Here it's a little bit simpler to see because there's no stride. So here you can just see there's a padding, 2 pixels on each side. And this will achieve the opposite, so going from a 2x2 input into a 4x4 output. Whereas at the top, we go from 4x4 to 2x2. Okay, so here's the equation if you want to compute the output size given the input. So S is the stride here. N is either the height or the width. If it's quadratic, it could be the same. K is the kernel size, and P is the padding. So you can use this formula to compute the output size of a transposed convolution. In PyTorch, this is torch nn conv transposed 2D. And here I just have some examples applying this equation to just make sure that this is indeed how PyTorch behaves when you look at the outputs. So you can plug in these numbers here for different kernel sizes, strides, and padding. Different input. I didn't change those. You can play around with those if you're interested. I only changed the input size here. But yeah, you can play around with this, and you should see this is how PyTorch computes, or how you would know the output given a certain input size, kernel size, and padding. And notice also, one interesting aspect about that is also compared to a regular convolution, if you increase the padding, it decreases the output size. In a regular convolution, if you increase the padding, it will also increase the output size. So it's the opposite. Here, padding decreases the size. In regular convolution, it increases the size. So you have to kind of think backwards now. Okay. So yeah, this was the transposed convolution in a nutshell. One problem that might occur in practice, I honestly don't see it very often, but there's this problem of the checkerboard patterns. So if you're interested, there's an interesting article about that with nice visualizations. And because of overlaps in this transposed convolution, which is highlighted here, so these dark pixels, what might happen is that you might see certain checkerboard artifacts. So let me show you this slide again. This is the very first slide I already had earlier. So again, here the regular convolution, and here this is the transposed convolution. And you can see, so when I have, this is not the emulated one, this is the regular transposed convolution, how I like to think about it. So what you can see is when you go from this input here into the output, and then do this for the next one, and you have a stride of 2, you can see here there's some overlap, right? So there's some overlap here. And then if you go down, then this one would be the area here of the highest overlap, right? So it would overlap all 4 kernels at the end here. So, and this can cause like certain checkerboard artifacts, which are highlighted here. So you can see here these kind of artifacts. There's some sort of pattern that appears here. And in this article, for instance, they then instead recommend not using a transposed convolution, but you use a regular convolution, or essentially using nearest neighbor upsampling followed by a regular convolution instead of using transposed convolution. Actually, I tried this out. It works well too. So either way, I think is fine. If you use transposed convolutions, just you have to be careful that you don't encounter checkerboard artifacts. In this case, if you have a setup like this and you may have a checkerboard artifact, how you would avoid this, or how you could avoid it, is essentially by just using a 2x2 kernel, right? If you have a 2x2 kernel and then you move it over by two positions, so the first one would be here, then you move it by 2 pixels, the second one would be here, and the last one, well, would be cut off. But so you can technically try to avoid it by choosing your kernel size and stride such that there are no overlaps. But also, even if there are overlaps, usually, or it's not always true that you find these checkerboard artifacts. So you have to just look at the results and see if there's a problem, and you can optionally replace transposed convolutions by nearest neighbor upsampling and a regular convolution. If you're interested in that, I don't have a code example here, but I can share a code example with you on Piazza. So if you're interested, just ask me. I can share a code example showing you how to implement that. It's not a big deal. All right, so that was convolutional autoencoders in a nutshell, like explaining how the transposed convolution works and so forth. And in the next video, I will show you how we can implement a convolutional autoencoder in PyTorch.